Please welcome Senior Vice President and Chief Technology Officer, McAfee, Steve Grobman.
Aerospace. Flight in the 20th century has changed every aspect of our lives. We now move between continents in hours, not days or weeks. Businesses, supply chains, economies are all conducted globally, and our ability to explore the world and the universe has been ever changed. But this has also changed the impact of war. During World War II, over 2 million casualties were killed as a part of air conflict during bombing campaigns by Allied and Axis powers alike. And many argue today that air power is the primary means to victory during conflict. At the core of flight is the Bernoulli principle. It's essentially what describes why a wing creates lift. But a wing doesn't actually know whether it's connected to a life flight rescue mission or a plane about to drop bombs on innocent civilians. Which is why in 1948, Orville Wright was asked, "Do you regret inventing the airplane?" And he said, "I feel about the airplane much as I do about fire. It can cause tremendous damage, yet can also be used for thousands of important uses." Orville's insight is that technology doesn't comprehend morality, something that our industry, cybersecurity, constantly struggles with. A prime example is cryptography. The exact same algorithm can protect data from theft or hold an individual or organization for ransom. This matters more than ever today, as we now encrypt over 150 exabytes of data every single month on the web, while at the same time see record exploitation from ransomware. This paradox was debated right here at the RSA conference during the 1990s. At the time, we debated whether you could conditionally use strong encryption. The United States government actually considered encryption a munition with strict export regulations. It was an impassioned debate. There were minor forms of civil disobedience, things like wearing T-shirts printed with bare bones implementation of RSA, algorithms and other forms of minimalistic source code, things that actually looked like this. But each of us here today, including a large contingent of scientists, mathematicians, cryptographers, recognize that encryption at its core is just math. And you can't stop someone from doing math. The challenge is to capture lightning in a bottle, to unlock the power of innovation, to seize its promise of advance, like fire or flight, without burning down the proverbial house. All in the service of our cause to better defend the digital world. As it does, history is close to repeating itself. Regardless of how you define it, artificial intelligence is the new foundation for our entire industry, and it will enable us to better defend our environments. Artificial intelligence will allow us to better detect threats beyond what we've seen in the past. It will enable us to out-innovate our adversaries. Artificial intelligence will solve other key issues that we as an industry face. It will be key to addressing the talent shortage, where we can now delegate tasks through AI-based automation in order to free up our talent to focus on the most complex and critical elements required to defend our organizations. And artificial intelligence allows us to evaluate data at scale, to find that needle in a haystack of needles that has challenged us for decades. But we must ask, are we looking at artificial intelligence objectively? As with other technologies, be it fire or flight, we can't only focus on the potential, we must also understand the limitations. We must understand how artificial intelligence will be used against us. In the interest of progress, Datasets of all kind are being made available for open analysis. Right here in the city of San Francisco, over 400 datasets are being made available to the public in a wide array of areas, things such as energy, infrastructure, and of course, public safety. When you look at the public safety data set, it's a record of crime that has occurred in the city by incident. And we can see the good that modern data science offers when applied to this data. We can now optimize where police officers focus their patrols. We can identify hotspots of crime in order to train citizens to make the city safer. But the exact same data set, along with the low barrier to entry of machine learning, could enable a criminal to be more effective in their endeavor. A criminal could use this exact same data to figure out how to commit crime more effectively, to minimize the probability of their arrest. To demonstrate this, we did exactly that. With 50 lines of Python and a machine learning model out of the Spark library, we built a model to predict whether an arrest would occur for specific parameters of a crime. And the map you see behind me shows the outcome of that model. The green dots are where the model got it right, essentially giving the criminal a go for getaway. To help us look in depth at artificial intelligence as well as its limitations, it's a true honor to invite McAfee's chief data scientist, Dr. Celeste Fralick, to join us. You know, I am fortunate to work with Celeste every day to solve some of the thorniest technical issues that our industry faces. But she has fans far beyond McAfee. Celeste was recently named by Forbes as one of America's top 50 women in tech. Celeste, welcome, congratulations, and thanks for being with us at RSA.
Thanks, Steve. It's great to be back at RSA with my fellow engineers.
Now, Celeste, the model that we're looking at behind us, that was built with basic machine learning, but it could help a criminal be more effective at committing crime. Well, what's up with that?
Well, Steve, it's a simple classification problem, essentially predicting whether a crime should be classified as arrested or not arrested, using factors such as type of crime, locale, the precinct, and even a simple implementation, as this chart shows, delivers surprisingly good results.
So the model uses past data during its training phase in order to find the signal in the metadata of noise to best predict the criminal's fate.
That's right. The model has no idea whether it's learning to detect cancer or optimize a crime spree.
So from the model's perspective, it's just math.
Yep, it's just math.
Now, you mentioned cancer detection. I know it's an important cause in your life as an advocate for research, because you're a survivor.
I am. I'm a stage 4 breast cancer survivor. It's an adversary that I fight every day. Thank you. And I rely on AI and machine learning every day to remain healthy. I now encourage every one of you to tell your moms, your sisters, your aunts to go get a mammogram. It saved my life, and the men too.
Awesome. Well, Celeste, your experience as a survivor and an engineer gives you a unique view into our challenges. In the physical world, we look at models that are detecting cancer, helping us fight crime. For this audience, let's go ahead and pivot back to the cyber domain. You know, one of the things that we need to think about is how can artificial intelligence and machine learning be used by a cyber attacker to make their attacks more effective and difficult for us to defend against?
Well, Steve, it's exactly the same as it is in the physical world. Machine learning and other forms of AI make even cyber criminals better, faster, and smarter.
So cyber criminals could look at their victims in a similar way as a classification problem. Out of all the machines that they might attack, which ones would be predicted as being more vulnerable or less vulnerable, and then going after the more vulnerable ones.
That's right, which is exactly why we looked at this problem from a cyber criminal's perspective and created a model to do just that. This model shows the machines easiest to exploit.
So if I was a cyber criminal, I could look at the output from this model, start with the machines in the top right quadrant, and the model is predicting that they have the highest probability of being vulnerable, and I would start my attack there. Clearly, cyber criminals could use artificial intelligence to make all sorts of things better that we need to worry about. What are some of the things that you worry about with AI being used for illicit activity?
Well, definitely social exploitation. Unfortunately, AI is well suited to generate false content that's highly believable. For example, deepfake video can create realistic footage that is 100% fabricated, making it appear that individuals are making statements or involved in activities that have not occurred. See, Steve, deepfake video or deepfake text can be weaponized to enhance information warfare.
Okay, so number one, I did not say that. Number two, that is not my voice. Can you explain what that was and what that video was all about?
Well, sorry, I know it was a little creepy, Steve, but it's just math, okay? I used freely available recorded public comments by you to create and train a machine learning model. That let me develop a deepfake video with my words coming out of your mouth. It just shows one way that AI and machine learning can combine to create massive chaos.
So it makes me think of all sorts of other ways in the social engineering realm that AI could be used by attackers, things like social engineering, phishing, where adversaries can now create automated targeted content in order to make the probability that an individual falls for a fish more effective.
Exactly, which essentially combines the effectiveness of spear phishing with the scale of traditional phishing.
So you and I often discuss cybersecurity as an industry and how different it is from many other industries that use artificial intelligence and machine learning, in that most other industries don't have an adversary trying to evade the model. I think about weather forecasting, where if you build a model to effectively track a hurricane, as the model gets really good, it's not like the laws of physics change and all of a sudden water evaporates differently.
Yeah, exactly. In fact, most people don't realize how fragile AI and machine learning can really be. There's an entire technical area that my team is involved in called adversarial machine learning. We study ways that adversaries can evade or poison machine learning classifiers.
So meaning that an adversary can change very small portions of the data that's being sent to the model in order to make the model reach an incorrect conclusion.
Exactly. In fact, for example, I recently cruised South America and Antarctica to celebrate a milestone of being cancer-free.
Congratulations.
Oh, thank you. And it was a great trip and great photo opportunities, including my favorite, the rockhopper penguin. He kind of has my hair. So I've manipulated this photo, imperceptible to us as humans, with a few pixels, but a machine learning classifier has a high degree of confidence that this rockhopper penguin is actually a frying pan.
Okay, so that kind of freaks me out, because when I look at these two pictures, me as a human, they look exactly the same,
they
but
do.
The underlying slight differences in the value of the color is making the machine learning model totally fall apart. I think about other places that were using artificial intelligence in the physical world. If an autonomous driving vehicle pulls up to a stop sign that has been slightly manipulated, could it now appear as a speed limit sign and drive right through? You know, one of the questions that I think is in the mind of the folks in the audience is, could the same techniques that are being used to confuse an image classifier be used to confuse our cyber models?
Well, absolutely. In fact, way back in 2004, this technology was actually used to fool spam detection. Attackers used early versions of these techniques, but what's critical now are things like looking at the impact of adversarial machine learning on malware classification and other cyber defense models.
Celeste, you and your team are a great role model for the industry because you're looking at AI holistically. You're looking at the limitations, how to have it do incredible things for us. I do want to thank you so much for the great work you do, but also for being part of this industry. Thank you so much.
Thanks. Anytime.
So clearly, we must recognize when using artificial intelligence as the foundation for defense, it is different. Because our models need to be tuned to high sensitivity in order to deal with things like evasion that Celeste and I just discussed, false positives are inherent. So understanding the cost of false positives is critical. Because false positives can have catastrophic results. The quintessential example of this occurred during 23 tense minutes on September 26, 1983. It's the height of the Cold War. Several international incidences have both the United States and Soviet Union on heightened alert. It's against this backdrop nearly four decades ago that the Soviets detect five US missiles launched against them. But with sirens blaring and screens flashing, things like launch and missile strike, Lieutenant Colonel Stanislav Petrov decides to report the incident as a malfunction. His ability to comprehend that the attack looks inconsistent from what is expected makes all the difference in the world. Because why would the United States launch World War III with five missiles? Petrov ignores his training manuals that instruct him to escalate. And fortunately, his tuition halts full-scale escalation of nuclear war. He prevents mutually assured destruction on all sides. In this case, the root cause was a rare alignment of sunlight on high-altitude clouds. But imagine if the entire response were automated, or if the results of detection were processed without understanding the broader context. Well, the impact of false positives in our organizations likely won't start World War III. They can have catastrophic results. They can cause us to shut down factories or other critical systems. They can cause us to divert resources from essential activities. Artificial intelligence actually isn't intelligent. Models create outputs based on inputs, but a model is just math and doesn't comprehend the full situation. Only people can comprehend the complexity that the real-world scenarios present. So let's be realistic about the immense power of AI-based technology. It does solve a host of problems for our industry, including making our defense stronger. But it also intensifies our adversaries' capabilities. It improves their ability to execute attack. It enables creation of content to be used in social exploitation and information warfare. These and many other adversarial uses of AI can and will occur. But we can't allow fear to impair our progress. We must keep in mind the technology itself doesn't have a moral compass. As with fire and flight, it's how we manage the innovation that is the real story. Nothing is more exciting or fulfilling for all of us here at RSA in our pursuit of making the world safer. We must embrace artificial intelligence, but never forget the limitations. It's just math. It's fragile, and there is a cost of both false positives and false negatives. But when we collaborate to invest in the right technology and deploy it with our eyes wide open to its strengths and its weaknesses, we will create the 21st century technologies that reshape the human experience as dramatically as the technologies from the last century that nurture sparks of innovation and truly light our way forward. Thank you.